My name's Giles Coren. I'm a writer, glutton, and, as luck would have it, a restaurant critic. I'm being joined by abstemious broadcaster Sue Perkins on an extraordinary gastronomic adventure. Over the coming weeks, we'll be scuffing our way through six periods of British history. Each week, we'll be medically tested, dressed the part, and forced to devour the breakfasts and banquets of Britain's glorious culinary past. Our gastronomic journey this week will take us back to the England of our youth in the 1970s, a time of excess and experimentation. We'll be knocking back the cocktails, feeling saucy over lunch.
Tell you what, that's the spirit of the 70s there.
Gosh, we go.
And getting fit 70s style. In 1971, I was two. Across London, Sue was growing up almost as cute as me. I can't wait to revisit the food. All I can remember is the ice cream. While older kids expressed themselves through music and outrageous clothes, our parents spent their recently decimalised currency at the shiny new supermarkets opening every day. This time, I'll be living the life of a high-flying advertising executive. While Sue balances a part-time job in a travel agent's with looking after our suburban bolt hall. We'll try to keep pace with the 70s jet set and guzzle our way through the decade of our childhood. In an era where everything was over the top, infamous TV chef Fanny Craddock epitomised an increasingly colourful approach to cooking.
And nobody wants those nasty little paper-thin slices they give you in restaurants. Thank you so much for watching.
Worried about the effect such outrageous cuisine is going to have on my insides, I've come to University College Hospital, home to one of London's leading gastroenterology departments, for a stomach x-ray.
And hold your breath.
For the last 2 days, I've been taking marker pills designed to show up on the x-ray. The speed at which the pills are passing through me indicates normal bowel function, but Dr. Anton Emmanuel thinks fatty foods might bung me up.
So, with this diet, I'd expect you to have much more saturated fats in your diet. I'd expect you to have much more proportion of your calorie intake as fat, in addition to which you'd also be having more calorie intake. Mm-hmm. So I would imagine that you would have more markers. Put it very simply, on that x-ray you'd have many more of those little shapes visible. And I'd expect your transit to slow down in the course of a week.
With 21st century obesity rates running at 4.5 times those of the 70s, personally I find it hard to believe their diet was so much worse than ours.
People are eating about 750 calories a day more than they do now.
It's a lot.
A lot.
But they weren't fatter, I mean, they were thinner.
And that's an unbelievably important point, because the difference is now that we do much less, we're much less exertional as a society in the Western world. Mm-hmm. And actually, for all that we may sort of mock and laugh at the 70s diets, the big advantage of the 70s lifestyle is that there was much more disco dancing, much more exertion basically, than we have now.
Before I go, Dr. Emmanuel does have one piece of good news.
And is there. So that there is an air bubble inside your colon.
You're saying that is a fart waiting to happen?
That's tomorrow's fart, or this
really?
Afternoon's.
It's like, do you think, I feel kind of weepy, just seeing that little fart there on the x-ray, yeah. I'm almost...
It's part of you.
It's got little hands and feet, it's going to come out and...
Yeah, exactly.
It's quite daunting, the idea of having even more calories, 700 or 800 more calories. I eat quite a lot as it is, and I try and burn them up. I'm going to have to cycle everywhere or something I'm going to have to do tomorrow, because I really don't want to put on... I'm quite sensitive like that, you know. If I put 800 calories extra a day, I could put on half a stone. I don't want to do that. So as we head back to the Britain of our youth, we're facing an onslaught of calorie-rich, fatty foods.
Are we going to get profiteroles?
I'm looking forward to profiteroles. I'm also looking forward to your chopper.
I'm not going to be riding one of those.
Oh, come on.
38.
I've got to do a wheelie whilst eating Angel Delight.
As one of London's top advertising executives, my annual salary of 20 grand is equivalent to £190,000 today.
Groovy.
More than enough to keep us up to date with the latest fashions.
Zowie.
And foods. To guide us through the world of 70s cuisine, chef and food writer Mark Hicks.
Morning!
Now the man who made the Ivy and Le Caprice two of London's most fashionable restaurants is going to revisit the foodstuffs of his parents' larder.
Most of it is actually preserved, isn't it? It's frozen, canned. Very little fresh stuff, look.
Hmm. They were just newly into preserved and frozen stuff, weren't they?
It was, yeah, I think all they ate. It was the time of the deep freeze, wasn't it?
So you're sort of dreading this? Is this?
Well, I think it's kind of interesting, isn't it? You know, it's sort of... yeah, this is what our parents may well have cooked and thought was quite clever, you know.
It's amazing. Have you got anything which isn't wrapped in plastic?
How much sugar is in this?
First launched in 1967, by the 70s, Angel Delight was firmly established as a children's favourite.
Angel Delight, are you going to open it now?
Yes, because you just...
for pudding.
You just add water. You can just put it in your mouth. You never made a mouth Angel Delight before. Butterscotch. Mmm.
In 1973, 10 years before the introduction of skimmed milk, we were drinking a million creamy, full-fat pints a day.
Yeah, I just think there was no consideration for calories. I mean, not that I go shopping for calorie, you know, sort of low-calorie food, but, you know, everything was, like, full-on, wasn't it, you know?
To top it all off, a fully stocked cocktail cabinet was essential in 70s suburbia.
Advocat, a drink made from lawyers.
Dutch lawyers.
That looks nice, doesn't it?
It's one of those Christmas things that you used to get left over.
You'll like that. It's on a sugary egg and...
Oh, that's naughty custard. That's bad custard.
That's nice. I've already had more calories in the past 10 minutes than I normally have in a day.
The thing is, it's nostalgic. You think it's going to be the food of your youth and you're going to approach it with sort of glee. But actually, as you say, it's pretty depressing. There's not a lot of fresh fruit and veg here.
To kick off our week of 70s gluttony and style, Mark's cooking one of the decade's more unusual breakfasts, a 1970 Fanny Craddock recipe of baked loaf stuffed with bacon and mushrooms.
I don't know, it was all about presentation and everything. It wasn't, you know, simple cooking, so everything had to be sort of, you know, played around with a little bit. We've even got 70s bacon here, because all the water that's coming out of it. That's, you know, you've got your bread, you've got your eggs, you've got your bacon and mushrooms. And what you're doing is actually making a complete hash of the whole stuff.
Of course, no breakfast is complete without a couple of glasses of sherry thrown in.
It's a bit like a mushroom bacon soup. Really thick. Quite disgusting, really. I mean, I suppose it's quite a novel breakfast dish, but... Look at that. Shocking, isn't it?
We'll be having our breakfast in the kitchen, as more relaxed post-war eating habits saw family meals eaten outside the dining room for the first time.
Breakfast, grilled grapefruit, boiled eggs with soldiers, Croûte forestière.
Hot, sweet grapefruit lake. Oh, that is sweet.
This grapefruit has been cooked in true 70s fashion, covered in brown sugar and grilled.
I mean, now you just have a piece of grapefruit, I guess. But this is, let's put sugar on it and a bit of butter and roast it and possibly put some crème de menthe.
It'd be a lot nicer if it was cold.
Less conscious of cholesterol intake, we ate twice as many eggs as we do today.
Oh, that is a delicious soldier.
Looking well.
Oh my God.
Unable to delay the inevitable any longer, it's time to try Mark's bacon and mushroom monstrosity.
I don't really understand that at all.
I
mean,
I wonder if they understood it, or if they just thought, oh, it's colourful, it's decorative.
Well, it's just sort of mushrooms and bacon served in.
It's like a composite English breakfast, isn't it? It's sort of, they've taken the idea of a garlic bread, but just added a pig and half a bottle of Harvey's Bristol Cream.
The fact is, it was the 70s, it was fun because they went out to discos and had funny clothes. It doesn't mean breakfast had to be fun.
So you have to work?
Yep. Time and tide works for no man. Good fun, dear.
Well, see you later.
Full of sherry and fatty bacon, I'm heading for the heady world of 70s ad land. While Sue, who works only part-time, can look forward to a day of domestic bliss. The most important part of any 70s ad man's day was lunch. In a time before office workers spent their midday breaks at the gym or nibbling sushi at their desks, their 70s counterparts perfected the art of the long, liquid lunch. I've come to Julie's, a 70s hotspot in Notting Hill, to meet a couple of ad men who can remember the heyday of the expense account. In 1973, 4 out of 5 restaurant meals started with an aperitif. We're having tequila sunrises and Harvey Wallbangers.
So cocktails before lunch?
Absolutely, yeah. And not only just cocktails before lunch, but I can remember actually going to discos at lunchtime. with secretaries, and they'd be drinking cocktails and dancing in their handbags at lunchtime in
really?
The 70s. Yeah, absolutely.
These are successful executive type people.
Well, they were everybody from the agency who didn't really want to do any work for the rest of the afternoon.
Lunch. First course. Rouget grillé, garlic rolls, chardonnay.
70s chefs rarely filleted fish such as this red mullet, preferring instead to serve it whole.
Of course, this is great. Mm. This is really, really good.
Really, it's nice.
Yeah, really, really fresh.
Yeah.
That whole thing with rouget, you know, oily fish like that, and that sort of mackerel type of thing, you need, has to be very, very fresh and very firm and no smell.
Second course, duck à l'orange, mixed vegetables, Bordeaux.
But it's almost a cliché dish now, isn't it? So.
Almost. Mm. It's come through cliché, out the other side, into people don't even believe it happened anymore. Mm. There are duck à l'orange deniers who make a career out of whole books which say that it never happened.
It never happened, well.
Oh, very good, though.
Mm.
While posh restaurants might have used fresh oranges, 70s chefs on a budget sometimes made this dish with marmalade.
But does it exist in France? That's what I'd like to know.
I don't think so. No, I think it's an arrestable offence. Mm.
Dessert, creme brulee, more red wine.
Would you order a creme brulee now? I would
order a creme brulee. You do still get creme brulee.
Yeah, there's very much.
Some people still pompously think that you can measure a restaurant by the standard of its creme brulee. Mm. Is this a good one?
This one. I'll
finish it.
The 70s was the decade when our post-war belief in the power of science and technology to improve our quality of life reached new levels.
It's over now to the factory and its recipe computer.
With 57% of former housewives now at work, a boom in convenience foods led scientists to produce increasingly synthetic ingredients as Britain fell in love with the TV dinner.
What do you fancy tonight? If you could let your imagination run riot.
Ooh, I don't know. Have you got anything dehydrated?
What, that needs rehydrating?
Anything that needs water adding to it.
Do you want something in a tin that's powdered that doesn't resemble food in any way?
I'll keep my socks on.
Oh.
As well as flavouring, colouring and water, a massive 11% of each of these faggots is real meat.
It's lovely the way you get to express yourself through your food.
I know.
I have my work, you have your stove.
By the end of the 70s, 2 out of 5 households owned their own free, allowing for a boom in products such as boil-in-the-bag fish.
This is what I remember. I remember my mum just permanently wandering around like that, trying to cover it.
Some of my friends married professional women, but not me, darling, eh? I just wanted a beautiful little thing who liked pop music and didn't mind rehydrating a bit of smash. I see there was a spot of trouble over at Lord Lucan's place.
Well, they say he's gone missing.
The fact says here, yeah, the nanny bought it, and he's he'll show up sometime, maybe at the end of the week,
he'll
probably.
Pitch up, yeah.
It's always those disappeared people.
It wasn't just food that scientists were meddling with in the 70s.
Right. Good God!
The joys of SodaStream meant you could also pack your drinks with additives and preservatives.
It's not fizzy.
TV dinner first course. Boil in the bag fish. Faggots. Crispy pancakes. Smash. Tin vegetables.
That's the sort of food that you long for a power cut to interrupt.
My God, now that looks truly horrible, darling.
Thank you, love. I'd like to say I made it myself.
Putting chicken and ham inside crispy pancakes was the ideal way of packaging them with phosphates and citric acid.
Oh, that's good. That's like eating baby food out of a hot slipper. And these peas taste so fresh, you must have opened the tin only minutes ago.
Smash's manufacturers proudly claimed that 82% of their product was pure potato.
You'd think, though, if you merely removed the water from a potato and then added it back later, the thing that came back would taste like potato.
This is the sort of thing that made 70s television enjoyable.
Colour broadcast first started in 1967, and kids like us grew up watching Bagpuss, Magpie, The Generation Game and Top of the Pops.
Oh, turn it up.
Pudding, butterscotch angel delight, banana custard, Arctic roll.
Bananas and custard I used to like, but to be fair, it wasn't as grim as this. It was hot custard on the night. Choked to death on 100,000.
Sales of frozen puddings such as Arctic rolls doubled during the 70s.
Was it ice cream?
No idea.
That's the thing, it's just more beige. The tongue is so furred with chemicals, I can't even tell.
The immediate success of Angel Delight when it launched at the end of the 60s doubled the market for instant desserts.
Are you sure it's butterscotch, not coffee flavour?
It's butterscotch, right? Okay.
I just got four different amorphous brown slimy things. I can't tell where any of them are.
Those TV dinners, those brains faggots. This made of stuff I'm never going to digest. No kind of idea about health at all. So excited about everything that's new, about sliced bread and E-numbers and preservatives and all this rubbish going to last forever in the freezer. I've got stuff here which is going to be passing through my system for months to come.
I'm feeling a little bit hyperactive and, you know, I think mental is the correct word.
Day two, when I'm taking Giles back to the 70s of my youth. In 1975, I was six and spending all my days free from annoying boys like Giles at this all-girls school in Croydon.
I wonder if they still use the birch here.
For what?
Discipline. It's very formative. It's made me the person I am.
At last, in a classroom full of six-year-old girls, I've got people more stimulating to talk to than Giles.
But you know how long ago I went to the school? It will frighten you how many years ago. I don't even think
it's
your brain...
Yes, I can't concentrate because Sue keeps talking.
Giles is being horrible, miss.
Can you concentrate when she's talking?
Yes! It's come
back in the 70s, all that hopscotch and catch was hungry work. And the dinner bell could never come soon enough. Our childhood saw the end of the golden age in school catering. In 1971, Education Secretary Margaret Thatcher stopped free milk for kids over seven. 9 years later, as Prime Minister, she ended the requirement to provide hot meals for all children.
Never pushed in! It was him who pushed in!
We're having some very 70s-style liver and veg cooked the old-fashioned way.
I put a bit of salt in this mash, but for the kids, I wouldn't normally put salt in it. We use a lot of fresh herbs and flavoured oils nowadays.
School lunch. Liver and bacon, lumpy mashed potatoes, boiled cabbage.
That's the taste of my childhood, and that's why I permanently had this look on my face.
That's the taste of my shoes. Oh.
Cooked until it had the texture of a green flash gym shoe, liver was the ultimate test of a 70s school kid's appetite.
Want to try some? Do you want to try some?
Does anyone want to try the potato?
Pudding. Chocolate sponge. Chocolate custard with the skin on.
It's chocolate sponge and chocolate custard.
It really is. I've not seen that. But normally it used to be really grey, pale colour.
Get off my pudding.
It's horrid.
Do you know, when I was at school, we said this every day. Can you imagine? It's paradise. Mm. And the sponge was so big it looked like a duvet. Just this huge duvet in a tray of sponge.
Anyone who is prepared to admit that boys are better than girls can have the whole bowl.
Okay, who thinks that the 1970s pudding was better than the crumble pudding of today?
So that's 70s sponge and custard 1, modern fruit crumble 0.
When they weren't at school, 70s children were spending their recently decimalised pocket money at the sweet shop.
Sugar. I'm gagging on a dib-dab.
In 1973, as shelves bulged with rhubarb and custards, flying saucers and pear drops, one in four children were at risk of false teeth by the time they were 20.
Look!
My Jacks!
They were horrible.
No, they're delicious.
No, they're horrible.
They're fantastic.
But look at them. Look at the bracelets, and then you eat one and then you've still got a bracelet.
What?
And mine's, it says a digital watch. What's that?
This is 1972.
Gold nuggets! I don't believe it. Look, remember gold nuggets?
No.
No?
They yes, I do. Yes, I do.
Remember, they have they're sort of a bubblegummy thing.
Johnny cigarettes.
Yeah,
brilliant.
Long before 21st century killjoys suggested that chocolate fags might encourage smoking, 70s kids could spark up in peace.
The great thing about these is the polythene's just as hard to open as it is on real fags, and so you can practice when you're nine, getting the polythene off when you're really gasping for a fag.
Actually tastes worse than a real cigarette. That's the thing. I'd rather eat a real cigarette than...
I just can't wait to grow up and be allowed to have real ones. Mm.
In the 70s, 1,000 tonnes of sherbet fountains were produced every year.
Who are you going to do all that?
I could do the whole lot. I can mainline sherbet like you've never seen.
bubbly bubblegum was made by Bassett, then the biggest sweet manufacturer in Britain.
It's literally like standing next to a field of cows masticating. Right, well, only just started. I'd like a couple of milk bottles, three sugared wraps, a couple of lips, a gum, some roots. Well, this has been a lovely trip down memory lane. Listen, we have to get out of the shop there, you know, because there's a sign that's saying only one person from the 1970s allowed at any one time, so I should go.
Just in case it's another 30 years before we're back in the 70s, we're stocking up.
Thank you!
I didn't like any of your sweets, and that's why I'm not buying any or having any ever again.
38 years and I've still never tasted a pudding like chocolate sponge and chocolate custard. That is, it is nectar. That is ambrosia, that is. The kids are so sweet, they gave me this sticker. It says, I finished my lunch today. But they didn't have the sticker that I really needed, which is, I finished everybody else's lunch as well today. God, I love chocolate sponge.
Day three, and I'm heading for my part-time job in a travel agent's.
Hey, cats, how's it going? What's your baby doll? Hey, like the vibes.
With the rise of affordable air travel, the beginning of the 1970s saw a boom in package holidays.
Does not look... You sure? B-E-N-N-Y, Benidorm, Ben...
Aside from the latest in office equipment... One of the many perks of my job is access to the very best in air travel. Concorde made its first commercial flight from London to Bahrain in 1976. With tickets costing £4,500, or 12 grand today, you'd expect pretty good food. So we've come to Brooklands Museum in Surrey to check out the in-flight menu from the maiden voyage.
Concorde meal, aperitifs, caviar and smoked salmon canapés, Dom Perignon.
Have you got a button to call the stewardess? Because it says here that Dom Perignon's meant to be the 69. This tastes a lot more like a 90-something.
It's certainly a cut above a small bag of hermetically sealed nuts thrown at you by a woman with a DIY facelift.
Meals on Concorde's earliest flights were designed by the Roux brothers and Anton Mossiman, some of the first celebrity chefs to oversee menus for luxury air travel.
Gosh, this, you see, this was an age of glamour. This one, it was still glamorous.
Mac 2, just as you're going for a bit of caviar.
They don't go necessarily that well, caviar and smoked salmon. They're quite similar taste. You might want to have them, but you could pick them apart like you're doing.
Yeah, that's
unclassy,
what I'm doing.
But sensible.
Or I could just shovel a huge tower of dough into my mouth like you've been doing, which has, there's something so sophisticated about that.
Mmm.
Main course. Cold breast of chicken with foie gras and asparagus spears. Mixed green salad with vinaigrette dressing. More champagne.
Unusually for me, I'm going to eat my foie gras because it's the 70s and we didn't care about the ethical treatment of animals then.
Right. Well, the thing is, even in the 70s, I would have cared and I never eat it. So you could have mine and I'm going to have some nice chicken.
But I'll go to hell.
Yes, well, you're already there already.
But it'll be a 1970s hell where everyone's wearing flares. Mmm.
Mmm.
That's classy again, just... tossing the champagne onto the fur
just
coat.
Just hit away though, the Atlantic.
I'll buy you another fur coat when we get over there.
Yeah, that's what I need. Some more chinchillas electrocuted.
Dessert. Poached orange in Grand Marnier. More champagne.
Oh, Grand Marnier. It softens the blow of having to eat a citrus fruit that they have soaked it in liqueur.
Digestifs. Assorted cheeses, brandy, cigars.
What does a fellow have to do to get some more Dom around here?
Smoking wasn't banned on Concorde until 1997.
You can tell that's a woman brought up on ketchup, has no idea about cigars. This was the age of the nouveau riche. I've spent my life trying to be classy and fooling nobody. Actually, this was the very thing, wasn't it? Mm. Ooh, smoked cheese.
Oh.
Oh.
I love that.
Very 70s. Or is it not smoked cheese?
Your palate has lost none of its rigour, has it? It really hasn't.
It's either smoked or not smoked.
Oh, good.
I'm full of Grand Marnier.
Giles Coren, restaurant critic for the Times.
45,000 feet, I'm full of Grand Marnier.
It's either Grand Marnier or it's not Grand Marnier.
I've smoked a whole Havana.
I don't know whether
it's... Was that champagne or was it red wine?
From the skies to the slopes, no 70s holiday was more glamorous than skiing.
Come on in.
Woohoo! Yes!
I win, you pay for the melted cheese. Woohoo!
Après-ski fondue. Melted Gruyere cheese, bread cubes, boiled potatoes, Van Schul.
Oh, yeah. Oh, cheesy string. Dairy yarn I've got here.
As first-time skiers returned home with warm holiday memories, the fondue set became a staple of the 70s dinner party.
How much more fun can you have? You go skiing and then you have fun with food. Mmm.
Cool,
oh,
man.
My God, that's so delicious. Like, it's wrong, but delicious. I wondered what that aroma was, and I realised it's the smell of my own salopettes on fire. Yeah.
And, of course, the Van Schul. A great big deal made about it, but, in fact, English people have been drinking mulled wine for thousands of years.
Yeah, warm wine.
I have a feeling this could never end. There's
I
no,
can actually knit there, that into a jumper for you.
Look at that. It's basically going to go on forever. Is there a world record for this, do you think?
I don't know, but I may well ring Norris McWhirter and find out. In one. One, the whole ball. Ah! Oh, I tell you what, that's a catalogue pose, that is. That just says Nordic new man. Look at that. The sex appeal, the dripping fat coming off your chops.
That's a skiing accident.
Like all the best dining experiences, 70s fondue even had its own rules.
If you drop your bread, then you have to snog the person next to you.
Yeah, nice try, darling.
This is staying firmly on the stick. There's no wobble there.
You're trying to suggest
that's not
that
going
some
anywhere.
70s parlour game.
Yeah.
That's the thing is, they were such children. They had such a childish attitude to food. Oh, look, dip in the cheesy weezy. Also, oh, damn.
They couldn't actually...
I've lost it.
Sweet fondue. Melted chocolate. Angel cake. Apples. Cherries. Marshmallows.
You'd think that dipping marshmallow in chocolate would be nice, but I think when you've eaten all that dipped cheese, you don't want to dip anything else, do you?
And yet my hand is taking on a sort of mechanised motion now. It's just, I don't want to eat this.
This is the kind of, the 70s, they just kind of, they gave up at the end, didn't they? That's where Nouvelle Cuisine came from. They were just fed up with dipping things in chocolate and playing daft-ass games with their cheese.
Please don't let me have a fondue again.
Milk is the convenience food we all take for granted. The only people in the world who have it delivered to their doorstep.
In 1973, a fleet of milk floats would distribute the output of 3.5 million cows to homes across the country every day.
How are you today?
Oh, not bad, not bad. Did put another power cup last night.
Did you?
See you later.
Have a nice day.
Bye.
Bye-bye.
With all that full-fat milk and a more calorie-heavy diet, our 70s counterparts must have been burning off a huge amount of energy to stay thinner than us. Modern research suggests at least 800 calories a day more. On average, they were walking 66 miles a year more than we are today, starting with the morning walk to work, a 30-minute hike burning almost 150 calories. If there was a bus route on the way, a sprint to catch the route master would burn 20 calories. And when you finally got to the office, running up and down the stairs in buildings with no lifts would burn 10 calories every minute.
I'm going to get fit with one of the best-selling exercise books of 1975, an American hit based on NASA training techniques.
Just reaching up as high as possible, high as possible, reaching up. And then he moves from the reaching and the stretching to a slightly odd movement here. Be a cat. So it goes from reach high, reach high, reach high, be a cat.
When you've mastered the cat, there's the neck twist, the hunch, and finally the lope, or as I like to call it, the huggy bear. Stretching over, it's now time to feel the burn. To the rhythm of jazz standard, T for Two.
No boozy meal on my lunch break today. Instead, the 70s-inspired calorie burning continues. In the decade of Bjorn Borg, Jimmy Connors and an emerging John McEnroe, half an hour's tennis would burn off 300 calories. 10 minutes vigorous jumping would shed another 100. pounding the pedals of your chopper for 10 minutes would shift 80 more, before 10 minutes of cutting-edge skateboarding moves could skim off a further 50.
With my workout over, what better way to keep up the weight loss than with some 70s diet foods?
Diet food. Ryvita, Nimble Bread, Cottage Cheese, Strawberry Slim Fast.
Designed as a meal on its own, this Strawberry Slim Fast contains a meagre 220 calories.
Oh, it's like, I'm getting buttered carrot, lamb steak, homemade custard. But mainly strawberry. Mainly a lot of strawberry there.
Why worry about flavour when these cottage cheese-coated crisp breads contain less than 80 calories per slice?
Of course, if none of this worked, thankfully liposuction was invented in 1974, so scrap that, hoof the slimming shakes, get yourself down to somebody who could just withdraw the fat by a sort of pump action. I think it's a bicycle pump they used then, it was very early days. But hey, it did shift the weight.
Hello, love.
Hello, love.
Don't overdo it.
Is that a baby hammer in your pocket, or are you just slightly displeased to see me?
It's a baby hammer.
Right.
What are you eating, then? Well, I better go and get on with my work.
All right. Will you make me a nest of tables?
I have no real plans. I'm going to just go and give something a good hammering.
All right.
See you then,
baby.
Wow! Is that dangerous? With B&Q opening their first superstore in 1969, the 70s was a boom decade for DIY enthusiasts. Half an hour's vigorous hammering could help a chap burn off more than 250 calories. But getting a piece of homemade modern art level was another challenge altogether.
I call this level thing in MDMF, brackets, 1972.
After a full day of calorie burning, it's time for a pre-dinner cocktail. Mixing two colourful 70s classics, Campari and Advoca.
Hi.
Just in time for the cocktail hour.
Yeah. Is this mine? That's the first drink that I describe as piercing.
Next, cherry brandy with minty creme de menthe and soda.
Do you not find it pretty sexy when I'm doing this?
Home drinking boomed after 60s relaxations in licensing laws and pricing restrictions meant that supermarkets started selling alcohol for the first time.
I'm going to call that one plaque attack. See, you could rot your organs but have completely fresh breath with that drink.
Finally, cherry brandy with Advoca floating on top.
That is a cocktail.
Although originally made from avocados, by the 70s, Advoca was produced in its familiar egg-based form, a result of European distillers' inability to grow tropical fruit. As a reward for all our calorie burning today, Mark's giving us a treat. He's cooking a meal based on a 1973 Gallup poll, asking respondents to name their perfect meal if expense were no object.
What's your Mark?
Okay. Hello.
Perfect dinner. First course, tomato soup, Riesling.
I think the soup's quite boring to eat, and do you ever feel you're just constantly plunging your spoon into the bowl and picking up hot stuff?
If you're stopped on the street in a poll situation, okay, it's quite stressful. You're just going to go, tomato soup, as if to say, go away and stop asking me questions about what I want to sit down and eat in an evening.
It's just
trifle.
It's like family fortunes, isn't it?
Second course, prawn cocktail garnished with a tomato rosette.
Prawn cocktail dripping with Mary Rose sauce is perhaps the dish most symbolic of 70s cuisine.
I'd eat that every night.
Frozen food, iceberg lettuce.
But in a way, that's what's brilliant about prawn cocktail, is it takes things that you've got, that bit of lettuce at the bottom of the fridge, those little tiny prawns that are at the back of the freezer, and we make something that looks exotic.
Any 70s chef worth his salt had perfected the art of the perfectly flambéed steak Diane.
This is one of those dishes that traditionally would have got served and then flambéed at the table. So, that's kind of died out a bit now, you know, health and safety and all that sort of thing. You know, you very rarely see any flambé work in restaurants.
It is for a 4-day week.
Bubbling with brandy, shallots, butter and cream, This sauce was designed to be as rich and as alcoholic as possible.
That is really sweet.
To go with the steak, Mark's done old-fashioned crinkle-cut chips.
They really went out of vogue in the late 70s and 80s, I suppose, but I may start serving crinkle-cut chips again, I think. I quite like the idea of that.
Main course. Steak Diane, crinkle-cut chips, mouton cadet.
This looks like a very, very top-tastic meal, doesn't it?
It really does.
Looks groovy.
It does.
I would say.
Zowie. Wizard.
With 70s red meat consumption twice what it is today, it's no wonder they knew how to cook a steak.
Happy 1970s.
That is just the thing. You just never get that kind of thing with steaks now. There's tiny, tiny little chopped shallots which give you a little bit of crunch. You know, and then they have a little bit of sweetness from the shallot.
I don't know how many Diane's went into this, but it's really delicious.
These chips have been cooked in one of the factory-modified vegetable oils that dominated 70s cooking.
They're really good chips.
These were actually cooked in spry, crisp and dry, and they are a bit greasy.
Spry, wet and fatty.
Pudding. Sherry trifle. More red wine.
Hey!
Look at that.
Wicked. Oh no, the glacé cherries, yes, but they've also got glacé onion on there, I noticed.
Glacé courgette as well.
Yeah.
Is this a nice trifle or a not nice trifle?
Well, this is a kind of typical 70s trifle.
It's not a nice trifle. My first psychedelic trifle. All right, power cut. Listen, what I've done is I've put glacé cherries to light the way. They are phosphorescent.
Regular power cuts occurred throughout the 70s, from the miners' strikes of 72 to the winter of discontent in 78-79.
Just follow the green cherries. Green cherries. Oh, you dirty...
While 70s women experimented with daring shades of eyeshadow, the men hung on to their luscious moustaches, despite the arrival of the first disposable razors in 1974.
Do you like this outfit?
Today, we're getting ready for a very special day out. In the 70s, the sexual revolution of the 60s spread to suburbia, and neighbourhood swingers groups sprang up across the country.
The gullet is prepared, and, yeah.
This is not the kind of party where you can spit stuff out, really.
No, swinger go-go, I'm bang up for it.
We've come to meet Emily Doubley, a sex writer for women's magazine Scarlet, and 70s swinger Jeff Rosson.
Yeah, exactly. This seems quite small for a swingers party. I mean, this seems more like a bridge four, really, rather than something that's going to degenerate. But how many people would normally turn up in the 70s to all these sort of things?
You would probably have about 8-10 people around the table.
Is there a number which is too many? Is there a kind of optimum?
Yes, I think once you go over 16 people round the table, it tends to split into two parties.
Because you like to know their names, don't you?
You've got to be able to remember
them. A little bit about them, occupation.
Once it goes over 16, there's probably more than one cabinet minister there.
All this sex soon became intertwined with food. The 1972 bestseller The Joy of Sex took its name from an American recipe book called The Joy of Cooking and brought the language of gastronomy into the bedroom. As the sauciness spilled back into the kitchen, raunchy recipe collections such as Fanny Hill's Cookbook made an even more explicit link.
Fanny Hill's Lunch, French Kiss, Nymphomaniac's Prayer, Potatoes Mazok, Red Wine.
Jeff, is this the sort of stuff you eat pre-swing?
Not nowadays. In the 70s, there was a lot of food that was chopped up and mashed up, but I think people got on with the sex because they couldn't get on with the food.
This ox tongue has been cooked with butter, parsley, celery and onion.
I don't fancy that.
Can I slip you a little tongue?
Oh, go for it. Yeah, I'd love a portion from you.
Would you like me to slip you another portion?
Please. Go and get that tongue in you.
I can't.
Are you feeling frisky now?
Full of hormone-packed plant compounds, asparagus has been considered an aphrodisiac since the 17th century.
That's not very seductive eating style, darling.
It isn't, is it? Really frantic mastication.
Show me the seductive eating style.
We need another one to the 70s there.
Gosh, should we go? That's
Has that done it for you?
Has that eat it? Absolutely.
Oh, it has.
Is it as good as you thought it would be?
Absolutely.
Pudding. Alibaba, rum, banana candles.
Even Fanny Craddock was getting into the swing of things. These banana candles are based on a recipe from her magazine.
So this is the serving suggestion, obviously. Just...
You've broken it.
Gosh, you haven't done it with a man for a long time.
Oh dear.
I'll take these two, that's more my thing.
Do you the whole thing, or do you just want a ring piece?
I'll share your ring piece.
These babas have been doused in a sauce containing a quarter litre of rum and almost 50 tablespoons of sugar.
Everything joyful, erotic, sensual, and desirous has been drained from my body with this mouthful.
Yeah, but bananas are an aphrodisiac, actually. They're full of potassium, so good for sperm production.
Really?
Mm-hmm. I don't know how they kept up. I mean, this is a decade of non-stop gatto and indiscriminate sexual activity. I think the 70s go to show that you can't actually have too much of a good thing.
In the 1970s, London's sleepy restaurant scene experienced a rude awakening. An invasion of American burger bars included the arrival of McDonald's in 1974 and the opening of the first Hard Rock Cafe in 1971.
I think I'm going to have the Edison Lighthouse burger with an LSD and ketchup topping. What are you going to have?
I don't know, I'm gonna steal a guitar off the wall. Try not to get arrested for it.
We've come to meet waitress Rita, who was working here on opening day, and the professor of pop himself, Paul Gambaccini, who arrived in the UK as a student.
Well, did you start coming here in the 70s? Did you kind of gravitate to this gaff?
Of course I did, because I came to this country in 1970, and one of the many sources of culture shock was the inedibility of most of the food. We had a hamburger vendor outside of our college at Oxford, and he was called the Poison Man. It just wasn't the real thing.
American diner food. 10-ounce burgers. Fries. Chocolate milkshakes. Coke floats.
Did they have bigger mouths in the 70s?
It's a big dinner. This is the thing, you're right.
The hamburger joint, is it good?
It's enormous.
It's huge. Enormous,
yeah. I've been eating it since 1972, and I'm not even halfway through it yet.
Now, look at him. He's having trouble now.
I feel like I've eaten my shoes. And I'm not just talking about 21st century shoes. I feel like I've eaten those shoes. You know? Started out this show, it's going to be a really sort of glamorous 70s hip cat, and I am now just a fat man with indigestion and a stupid moustache.
American diner dessert. Yee-haw. Hot fudge brownie, hot fudge sundae.
You see, this is the first food I've ever had to actually excavate in order to...
Really?
Where is the brownie?
Oh,
look at that.
Yeah, but you're enjoying it, aren't you? That's the main thing, just enjoy life. Somebody said to me the other day, did I ever meet anybody that lived every day as though it was their last?
This is my last day.
I just can't stomach any more. I need to find a 70s antidote to fatty food.
Oh, God.
Although coronary bypass surgery had been pioneered at the end of the 60s, the late 70s had a different answer to heart disease. They called it disco. At the end of 1977, the underground dance moves of New York and Philadelphia burst into the mainstream with the arrival of Saturday Night Fever. There was the hand roll, the karate chop, the mashed potato, and of course the craze that was catching on everywhere in the 70s, the clap.
I've not eaten a burger for 25 years and then I ate that. Hard Rock Cafe. Hard Poo Cafe, more like.
Sleep through that, I've no idea.
Through what?
I love to wake up with a migraine.
I like to wake up with a big stripper.
Although the first electric tea maids were produced in the 1930s, it was in the late 60s and 70s that sales really took off.
Hmm?
Do you want some tea? It's been brewing for 9 hours. There you go.
Why is there one of those smash Martians next to the bed? Another bright 1970s morning. The rattle of the milk float. The rubbish bags piled high in the street because the dustmen haven't been since 1971.
As the 80s dawned, tastes moved on and the tea's made was consigned to history.
It is the sort of Betamax of inventions, though, isn't it? It's one of those things, and I think possibly the reason it failed was because people suddenly realised it was quite easy to just get up and go downstairs and make one themselves without the bright light and then... I've got terrible bedhead, but the good thing is I can just adjust it quite easily.
On the weekends, when there was no rush to get to work, a cooked breakfast was still eaten as a matter of course.
Here we go, Bloody Marys.
Cheers, Mark.
Fancy a threesome?
We're starting our last day with a meal containing almost 1,000 calories.
Ooh, a fried slice. I don't think I've had one of those since the 70s.
No, I've not had one since my last heart murmur.
Breakfast in bed. Fried eggs. Bacon. Fried bread. Bloody Mary.
They should have a Bloody Mary made. That would be fabulous. Just a sort of gentle whirring, a sort of tomato juice and vodka blends with a subtle range of spices. Oh, it's wrong. It's just so wrong, but it's just very nice.
The fried slice?
Mm.
The fried slice would go the way of the tea's made when 80s scientists proved conclusively that the 70s diet was damaging our health.
You'd eat this and you'd never be able to get out of bed. You'd have to just conduct the daily business, you know, in a prone position.
But then again, I suppose it's basically pretty Atkins, isn't it?
Just as Thatcher's Britain banished a world of three-day weeks and power cuts, growing health concerns did away with the 70s encouragement to enjoy a little of what you fancy.
The 1970s for me has been all about the gut luggage. There's so much luggage here. I'll be glad when the 80s break.
If that's always been the worry with breakfast in bed, what do you do with the tray? We're now trapped forever.
Yes, my legs are dead. Crapped under the weight of an English breakfast.
That's what free love is for, because basically if we were also sharing the bed with someone else, they could take our tray away.
What we need is a gimp at the foot of the table. A tray gimp.
Tonight we're celebrating our week in the 70s with our own version of the decade's most celebrated social event, the cocktail party. Mark's taking his inspiration from the original party queen, Fanny Craddock, and her 1973 bestseller, The Party Cookbook.
Who would have thought Ritz crackers would have been the base for smart 70s cocktail parties? I've got a bit of prawn cocktail with some paprika sprinkled on top. I've got anchovies. You can literally go into your larder, you know, really select almost anything and put it on a Ritz cracker and it's going to taste half decent.
Downstairs, we're doing our own party prep, starting with some table decorations.
This is Fanny Craddock's idea of a great night in, is just making lemon pigs. I suppose this is the sort of thing you'd do if your marriage was sort of dead from the waist down. You'd just think, well, what can I do? Read a good book or make a lemon pig. It's a no-brainer, isn't it? Put that on someone's plate. And that's the height of dinner party sophistication.
To accompany my beautiful pigs, some shiny silver gondola ends.
Nice little Viking helmet. Put the dilapidated wonky pig with the sat-nav eyes.
And what, does everyone get one, or is that just going in the middle of the table?
Well, I mean, I'm working on it, do you know what I mean? This is a very labour-intensive project. I can't promise that everyone will have their own, you know, personalised lemon pig.
I'm setting up my cocktail bar based on guidance in Len Dayton's Action Cookbook. He suggests serving such terrifying quantities of booze that I've had to reread it 9 times to make sure it's true.
And then he says a rougher way to calculate, and he's talking about spirits here.
Oh, good.
Is half a bottle per head each 2 hours.
That's about right.
Okay. Oddly enough, for each subsequent 2 hours, you must allow 3/4 of a bottle per head, since drinking will increase if they haven't gone home by then.
So he's in an ambulance.
He's actually saying, so you arrive at 7, and you drink half a bottle of, okay, Oddly enough, for each subsequent 2 hours, you must allow 3/4 of a bottle per head, since drinking will increase if they haven't gone home by then.
So he's in an ambulance.
He's actually saying, so you arrive at 7, and you drink half a bottle of gin. So I'm just saying that's what he's reckoning per guest.
Every 2 hours. But he's saying my drinking's going to increase now.
Then he's saying that by this stage you might be a little bit tiddly.
But now saying 3/4 of a bottle now, so 10 o'clock.
Now saying 3/4, so we've moved on to Lamb's Navy Rum, the 70s drink. Remember the girls with the big...
Yeah, yeah. And the... But first, by a bottle of gin, I don't care that it's rum.
And half of that again, so
half
then...
Half of that again. That's midnight now.
But the fact that he's catering for it, I think at this point in 1972, the responsible driver goes, wait, I'm driving.
Easy.
I won't have the last half a glass. According to Len Dayton's Action Cookbook, that
is from 6 till 2.
6 till 2 around the Dayton's place, each bloke.
Before improved breath tests cut the number in half, the 70s saw over 1,500 drink driving deaths a year. In the meantime, more conscientious drivers were drinking wine cup, a crafty way of stretching out your black tower with fizzy water and Curacao, a Caribbean liqueur made from orange peel, which first had blue colouring added to it in the 60s.
Okay. Aquamarine, that's how I like a drink.
Mmm.
That's living. So basically...
Now that, you see, that only costs about 9 pence in old money. That's cocktail.
As Mark finishes off in the kitchen, our guests have started to arrive. There's actress Jo Munro, who helped John Pertwee fight the Spider Queen in Doctor Who.
Oh, Matthias!
Pan's people dancer Dee Dee Wild and Henry Marsh from 70s band Sailor.
We bought a little off-wing.
Oh, Matthias, Rosie.
Hi!
70s historian Sue Harper.
I'm very good. Oh, Matthias.
Matthias, just what you need.
And food writer and 70s deli owner Glyn Christian.
Oh, what's this?
This is the cheese. The cheese, you can smell them.
God, how very nice. You haven't brought any Matthias?
Did you want me to?
Party food. Twiglets. Ritz cracker hors d'oeuvres. Cheese and pineapple. Coronation chicken vol-au-vent. Avocado and prawns. Swedish bird's nest. Steak tartare. Haddock mousse. Fish sandwich cake, roast chicken with green mashed potato, salmon and cucumber mould with liebfrahmel jelly.
I don't remember eating all this in the 70s.
Yes, we ate and drank much more than people do now.
Swedish bird's nest is a Fanny Craddock recipe of herbs, capers, raw onion, anchovy fillets and cold potatoes topped with raw eggs.
What's the derivation of the raw
I was going to say.
Swedish nest. So this is based on Brit Eklund, as you can see.
Enough looking, shall we eat?
Look, let's eat. Come on.
While Sue oversees the buffet...
No one's having any of the Brit Eklund nests, so I'm going to use this.
I've been relegated to bar duty. And my homemade wine cup's going down a storm.
You clearly are from the 70s, because with all this array of drinks, three of you said, oh, I'll have that blue stuff.
One of the more unusual dishes on offer is a fish sandwich cake. This cold party piece combines layers of prawns, sardines, canned salmon, and imitation caviar.
Everything out of a tin, including the lumpfish roll, some frozen prawns, lots of butter, lots of mayonnaise. Totally disgusting, really. I said this is probably one of the worst dishes I've ever made from a recipe book. What a waste of good smoked salmon, isn't it?
I can hear something screaming as that knife goes down.
That's my cardiologist.
Look at the layering.
Oh, thank you very much.
Is this some...
This is a haddock mousse, yeah. Now, this is very 70s. I remember my mum doing this to impress people.
This moulded dish is Mark's interpretation of 70s party cooking and contains salmon and cucumber held together with a Liebfraumilch jelly.
Yeah, on 70s they were crazy on aspic. They'd cover anything in aspic, including themselves.
But that lead from milk jelly on the Mark Hicks thing is absolutely fabulous.
Can I have a show of hands as to the following? I want to know if these are true or not. Okay, this is what we've learned. During the 1970s, people ate a lot more, 750 calories a day more. Fact?
Absolutely.
Yes.
And drank more.
No, because we didn't have
cars. Somewhat, chérie.
No.
We spoke a lot of French in the 70s.
Did you? Mm.
Pourquoi? Pourquoi? Because if you spoke French and did French food, you're considered to be very smart.
I'm sure no Frenchie ever faced Fanny Craddock's radioactive green mashed potato.
You know, afro, totalement afro, le pomme de terre vert.
Oui, c'est truly menti.
Comme manger les chaussettes d'un vieillard.
That in the 70s, it was extremely bad manners to talk about the food. Do you remember? Deeply
I'm not surprised.
You say trade pass.
It would have just been a series of expletives.
Dessert. Black Forest Gatto. Cheesecake. Cheese board. Baked Alaska.
Look at that.
Wicked.
Who fancies a piece of this?
Oh, yes. I do.
Look at the sexy slurp of that mothership. Oh, that's dirty.
Delicious.
That's a dirty dessert. Who wants it?
I would like some chocolate and cherry cake, please.
Black Forest Ghetto.
It's the only one there that's been drenched in alcohol.
It really has, hasn't it?
Is it Kirsch? Fabulous. Is it Kirsch?
Yeah. It tastes of petrol. It really does. It was strong.
I viewed the 1970s through a banister, the whole of it, all of it. I was on the top step, my little brother and my little sister were on the banister, below and below that again. And that's how we saw the 70s, through the wooden slats of my parents' staircase. And it's actually really nice to be in it. The whole thing is just, but it's fast and I love it. I love the fact that their food is just add water and go, fly, baby. And everything's going to be a bit slow now.
Oh, I suppose I might go back to my life, you know, my daily life, the restaurant critic, and going into restaurants and people, you know, restaurants now are so restrained and minimalist and elegant, and everyone, you know, everyone drinks water and has the odd little glass of wine, and they don't really bother with pudding, and everything's very small. And I'm going to think, oh, come on, let's have a huge Liebfrau Milch spritzer with blue curacao in it and a massive cake. Let's set the main course on fire. I don't want sushi. I want slosh it in brandy, set light to it, throw it across the room, wear a massive pair of flares, smoke a fat cigar, and have a huge cocktail. I think it's quite likely that I'll just want to take it all back.
After a week in which I've eaten more than 20,000 calories, I'm back at UCH to find out what effect all those fatty fondues and crinkle-cut chips have had on my insides. For the last 2 days, I've been taking another batch of Dr. Emmanuel's X-ray markers.
All right, I mean, this is your X-ray from last time showing that about sort of a third of the markers were still retained, primarily in the rectum and a few scattered around the rest of the colon. This time round, interestingly, there's just one little lonely marker sitting there.
Yeah.
So the rest of them are all cleared. And what that suggests is actually slightly contrary to what we were thinking. You've actually had a slight increase in your gut transit. In other words, this diet has made you go to the loo slightly more.
And is this more or less healthy than the previous one?
I guess if you are going to be eating a high-residue, high-calorie diet, you'd rather be brisker than slower.
So you think, and you do think that change has been brought about by diet?
I can't say. If nothing else has changed in you, if you haven't been taking laxatives and if you're still the same happy-go-lucky person you were last week, then this should be, dietarily, is the only thing that could explain the change.
But that's really interesting, isn't it? And we were talking about how they ate more calories but were still, relatively speaking, slimmer than we are now.
Absolutely.
Perhaps this is why. There's some mystery poo efficiency ingredient in 1970s food. I'm rather amazed. Obviously, that is the reason why people in the 1970s were thinner. I mean, it's possible that it also has something to do with the fact that the working classes were more involved in manual labour then than they are now, rather than just sort of sitting about on their bums eating the same diet. But and the middle classes haven't got any fatter, and this is probably clearly why. I think I'm going to stay on this diet forever. I'm going to go back to my life and have crinkle-cut chips and possibly be fit for the 2012 Olympics.
Next week, we're devouring the food that inspired Shakespeare. We'll be snacking on sheep's heads, nobbing about, and enjoying a frog pie.
Culture is everything that we're not that tells us what we are.
Culture?
Getting Indian.
Is
Thai.
The knowledge.
Chippy. Bit of dim sum.
Of the sensibility.
It's food, isn't it?
And the Culture Show talks to Ricky Gervais on Location next on BBC Two.